you know, my question was that history will record you, your contribution to poetry, you want it or you don't want it. Mm. So any particular thoughts that you would like people to remember you for? So
no, nothing much, because so many people have gone and then people remember, they don't remember. I don't know whether that sort of thing matters, but then I would be like to be remembered as an honest poet, a person who believed in what he wrote. And I like people to believe in what I wrote, not just take my things for granted.
Exactly. I think that is a very apt reward that any poet would like to have.
Yeah.
You know, the belief in their work.
Yeah.
And not by what they are already.
Right. Not by reputation, for example.
Exactly. Yeah.
Or by awards. These
correct.
These don't mean anything.
Correct. So, yesterday was your birthday and, you know, Rain failed to me to do the video. What was playing in your heart yesterday? Don't you feel that childlike passion in your heart? And you know, I'll scream out in the top of my voice. I didn't want to say something. Did you want to say something?
Nothing much like that. There was nothing like that. I didn't feel the difference between
any other
thing.
Okay. So yesterday you were also talking about Bukowski's writing career starting at 50 and Sexton's as a medical prescription down at 40. You also started writing at 40. So is it a boon or a, you know, bane for in the life of creative writers, specifically poets? Is it significant that, when they start writing late in their life, do they come with a lot of experience, valuable experience, which they at once start now discussing, penning down?
I would agree with you on that, that you have come to a certain stage, a certain point where you have had a lot of experience about things in general, about life, about living, about death. But if you go into the lives of the great poets, all the great poets have written, they started very young. Take for example Pablo Neruda. You know those lovely poems of love that he wrote when he was 18. I mean, nobody has duplicated them. They were so beautiful.
Yes.
Yes.
Very original.
And so that tells me that I'm just a very ordinary poet. I don't belong to that category. I began to write late because I wanted to write them. Okay. I wanted to write poetry then. But I started writing prose a long time back, although none of the prose was published.
So is it true that vices overpower the virtues of poets after a certain level of accomplishment? I see big businessmen talking down another businessman.
Mm-hmm.
Have you had such experiences, or in general, do you think that there is a little ego that brews up after a certain level of accomplishment, and you're very specific about your work and you cannot give much space to somebody who is newer in the genre or newer in the field?
Yes, there's a lot of truth in that, because there's too much of I when you meet a great poet, there's too much of I when they speak.
Mm-hmm.
And that perhaps is the vice, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the ego is such a terrible thing that it's difficult to play it down. And I don't know, I think the vices are there, and there is truth in that statement that people become vain, and they have to put up a certain, they have to put up certain airs. Whether they believe it or not, whether they are inside, they are the same people, same people as they appear outside. It's difficult to say. But I don't think there is a similarity between them. It's difficult for me to comment on that.
So, what miracle cure do you have in your this beautiful old house, you know, where, you know, people who are into writing can come over and, you know, replenish their exhausted fuel and start writing afresh?
I don't know. I love trees. I love nature. So I've planted a lot of trees and bushes and shrubs. And I like the sort of rural atmosphere that helps me to live. And when I touch the bark of a tree, the trunk of a tree, there is a certain feeling that enters me. And that feeling is something that connects me with nature, with the earth, with the sky. That's something I
it's
want.
It's a cosmic power.
Yeah. I don't know if there's cosmic power, but there is a desire inside man to merge, to fuse with the universe around him.
Yes. Going back to the first question where, you know, the recording didn't take place that time. We were talking about enough room after you were married to spend time with poetry.
Mm-hmm.
So, what was your take like? Did your wife also come with, similar artistic influence or kind of, you know, taste for literature?
You know, what was interesting in my life was that was my wife.
Mm-hmm.
She was interested more in poetry. So I used to buy her poetry books, but I never wrote myself.
Ah.
Nor did I read any poetry then. I didn't have that urge to read poetry. But I bought her poetry books and I bought them for her. I remember in Chennai, I bought a beautiful copy of Omar Khayyam, which is still there with me.
Lovely.
Yeah, so I don't know.
So somehow she was
over. Yes, there was something between us that was not mere sex and desire and all that. There was something else.
And she knew sort of that she is going to getting connected with poetry. Like sooner or later,
yes,
she did experience the poetry new coming out.
Yeah, I think so. I don't know.
And we were talking about the politics that goes behind nominating somebody for an international award, specifically if you look at Indian poetry for the last 100 years. 1923, when Tagore last was conferred that award, and it is 2013, 100 years. So, if not the novel, but to that stature, that kind of exposure hasn't been offered to any poets who we have for all these years, many resident poets who people do not know, who are not aware of. What actually goes behind all these things, you think? What politics could be playing here that they do not get that use?
I don't think I can answer your question. I have no answers for that.
Okay.
I haven't ever thought about it and then not have I discussed it with my friends. I've written because I wanted to write, and then that kept me occupied, that kept me busy, that kept me satisfied, contented. And there was, of course, that discontent in my contentment,
mm-hmm.
but that was how I related with my poetry. And I can't give you any answers to this.
No problem.
And yes, this was a question I believe you have answered, but just for the sake of recording, I'll re-record. About, how would you like people to remember you?
Oh my God. This? I don't know. I haven't thought of working.
Give yourself time. Pamper yourself.
No.
Poets, what do you want? Ask yourself.
No. I'd be happy if they call me a good man. That's it.
The poet has a very simple wish to fulfill.
No, I don't have any greater or sublime wish. No, I don't have.
Okay.
That's how I lived, you know. And I want to die like that too.
These days when you live alone, are you haunted too much by the presence of, I mean, by the absence of your wife?
No, it's strange. But somehow that I feel that she's here, that she hasn't gone away. I mean, somehow that my sleeping hours also, I see her.
Last night I saw you taking one side of the bed and turning over.
And the whole bed was empty.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe it was an unconscious movement of mine. I couldn't tell you. But then I don't feel that she is not here. That's how it is.
Okay.
Thank you.